We've all been to the zoo. But what happens when we're not watching?
Silly boy.
In this series, we've put cameras in more places the public never gets to see.
Every animal has some sort of personality. Not two are the same. Sometimes there is that temptation to just climb in and spoon with them, but no, it gets hacked.
Preserving endangered species, Chester Zoo is home to 20,000 animals.
Right, breakfast time!
Filmed over a year, these are their stories. New rivalries, new love affairs, and new arrivals.
Society, isn't it?
For the keepers who care for them, this is more than just a job.
There's always a danger. Something can go wrong.
You try to do your best.
Looking after them, so their kind of happiness, I guess, is down to what you do, and that's a really nice feeling.
It is a lot of your life being a zookeeper. You know, you do care about what you work with. You, even on your days off, it's still in the back of your mind. You never completely switch off.
The keepers spend so much time with their animals, they develop very close bonds.
You hear kind of various things about keepers not getting too close to their animals. It's not possible. You have to get close to your animals. It's the best job on the planet.
Excuse me. What are you doing? You care for these animals so much, and you spend so much time with them. I fixed that fence 3 times last week. But when you go on itch, you go on itch, I suppose. They're your friends, your family. Oh, well, guess what I'm doing this afternoon.
Keeper Babs has worked at Chester for 9 years. She spends much of her time trying to keep Florence and Nadine in order. They are two of Chester's rare Grevy zebras.
We get it all the time. Oh, they're just horse in pyjamas. It's not just a horse. They're still wild animals. And actually, if this horse doesn't really want to work with you, it will turn around, it will kick your head off, and it will bite you. Florence is kind of like, nothing bothers her. She will be in your face if you've got food, so she'll literally be all over you, and she wants it now. Good girl. The moment she's been fed, she's like, whatever, I'm chill beans. Yeah. Whereas Nadine is a lot more like a proper zebra. If you come too close to her, she's like, oh my God, my world's collapsing. Get out. Good girl. So the two characteristics are very different.
The herd's other member is Nadine's 2-year-old daughter, Merida, the youngster of the group.
Merida's growing up, so she's learning how it is to be a teenager at the moment. So she's kind of like that in-between stage where you have to learn once when a grown-up says no, they mean no, and if you push it too far, you'll get told off.
Grevy zebras live in small female groups in their native habitat of East Africa. And with less than 2,500 left in the wild, the keepers at Chester are desperate for Florence and Nadine to have foals. Last year, they decided to call on the services of stallion Mac.
I have no idea what's going to hit them. Poor girls. Stuff, he did his thing.
But the females didn't put up with him for long. Mac was bullied and had to be put back in his own paddock.
You proper meanies.
Now, a year on, the keepers are excited that both Florence and Nadine are pregnant. The birds could happen any day. Fixing an accurate due date for zebras is almost impossible.
We have between 358 and 465 days. That's the gestation level that we have at. And it's a nightmare, to say the least. I've been waiting for blooming ever for this foal. Just waiting for the moment to pop in and then we can have a baby on the ground.
Patience is everything for the keepers. Especially when it comes to the world's slowest mammals.
Sloths are weird creatures. They are quite shaggy. They have nice hair. They have ridiculously long claws, which could swipe your face off if they wanted to. They're not as cuddly as what people think. They do their own thing.
6-year-old Tina is a two-toed sloth.
Tina is a really feisty girl. She has a reputation for being a little bit more, not aggressive. Well, maybe aggressive. I think she's a typical sloth woman. Quite bossy, quite pushy, throws her weight around a little bit.
Sloths spend 15 hours of the day sleeping. They are so sedentary that in their natural rainforest habitat of Central and South America, moths make a permanent home in their fur. Tina has lived here for 4 years, and it's now time to think about starting a family.
She's never had offspring of her own. She doesn't know what it's all about. Hopefully instincts will kick in.
There are high hopes for a love match between her and her new suitor.
Rico!
17-year-old Rico from the East Midlands.
Hi, buddy. I think Rico has many attractive qualities. I think he's beautiful in his own way. But if I were a female sloth, he wouldn't be my taste. Tina's magnificent. Tina's like the Marilyn Monroe of sloth. She's absolutely stunning. And then Rico comes along and he's kind of got his funny little claws and his funny little face. And he's just like, oh, hello, quite like you.
But Tina hasn't fallen for his charms yet.
It's a bit unrequited attention. I think Rico's going to have to work very hard to seduce Tina. We'll have to give it some time and see if his persistence pays off.
Rico is not the only male at Chester unlucky in love. Iblis is an Asiatic lion, one of the planet's rarest animals.
Iblis, the male, he's quite bulgy. He's a typical man, basically. Bit of a bully sometimes. But at the same time, he's a bit of a scaredy cat when it comes to certain aspects of what he should be doing. He is a good-looking lion. From our perspective, anyway, he's quite a handsome beast.
He lives with 9-year-old lioness, Kumari.
Kumari's quite intelligent. I kind of think in the animal kingdom, you know, the females are the ones that you have to watch out for because, like lions, for example, it's the females that have to rear the cubs and do all the hunting, you know, so obviously they're going to be more intelligent than the males. Male lions are always stupid.
Iblis and Kumari have been together for the last 5 years, but they failed to produce cubs.
He's definitely still doing what he should, but she just doesn't seem to be very receptive towards him. And it may be that they've been together so many years that she maybe feels their relationship is more familial than, you know, sexual.
In the wild, obviously, she could go and pick and choose into who she wants to be with. She could mooch around and move between areas and pick a male that she quite fancies, really. Here, she's stuck with Iblis, whether she likes him or not. So, she hasn't really got a choice.
There seems to be nothing physically wrong with the pair.
Obviously, we've done fertility tests on Iblis and Kumari. You know, they should be able to make babies, but there's obviously something that's not right. And what that is, we don't know, really.
There are less than 500 Asiatic lions left in the wild. The pressure is mounting on Iblis to perform.
They're all in one place in India. They're protected, but if there was an outbreak of a disease or a natural disaster, it is entirely possible that the entire lot of wild lions could be wiped out in one go. So keeping a captive population is essential just in case, you know, as a backup.
The keepers have now decided to intervene and give nature a helping hand. They're going to try injecting Kumari with a hormone, which should boost her fertility.
She needs a bit of help stimulating her eggs being released. This is why you dart her at the peak of the season. And this drug should help that. But it has to be given at the right time. But the right time is kind of a bit of a guess.
The drug needs to be darted into her flank. But this is a precarious procedure. Iblis is standing guard. He's one of the most dangerous animals that live here.
So that she actually ovulates and she'll become pregnant and hopefully produce a few cubs in a few months' time.
Only time will tell if the treatment will help this couple have cubs. At 5 p.m, most keepers head home for the evening.
Help them, you can't be there, you can't hold their hand, you can't tell them it's going to be okay.
It's midnight, and in the zebra paddock, pregnant Florence appears restless.
With Florence, for instance, she's never had one before, so we don't know if she's going to be all right giving birth, but we can't help her. She's just going to have to do this on her own.
Chester hasn't yet opened its doors. But Babs has come in early to check on Florence, one of the pregnant zebras. The foal is only 2 hours old. And Babs hasn't seen it stand up yet. In the wild, newborns are easy targets for predators.
It's the most important thing. Get up, get moving, get eating. Survival 101. The longer you spend time on floor, the more vulnerable you are. Mums will kick, or she will nudge, or they will, like, squeeze a little bit, like, come on, you need to get going. And it can look really harsh, but it is important, and it's instinct. Instinct kicks in. A foal is the best thing in the world. Honestly, they are all legs. Their heads are the smallest thing in the world. Their bum doesn't even fit their body. The tail is this little stick with hair on. The stripes are all sort of meddled in with each other. All the fur is all ruffled.
The foal may be up and about, but it's not out of danger yet. It takes baby zebras a few days to recognise their mother as their own. So for the next 72 hours, Florence will be fiercely protected, even around the two other members of the herd. Pregnant mare Nadine overdue, Babs can't relax yet.
Everything could go wrong, so we're not counting our chickens yet. We just need them happy and healthy on the ground.
Struck Rico has yet to win the affections of Tina, the Marilyn Monroe of the sloth world.
Rico! Rico, come on!
Rico's like the girl's best friend that you never think of getting the girl, and I just really hope he does.
Hello, buddy. All right.
Now, Keeper Sam is trying a new approach to get Tina to notice Rico.
Good boy.
She's training them to come to her. It means she can carry out health checks.
Good boy.
But if Sam can get them both to come down at once, they'll spend more time together.
So we've just got to try and give them the best possible environment that we can. So it's a little bit like setting a room up with candles and Barry White, but instead of candles and Barry White, you've got nice enrichment feeders.
Rico, come. Good boy.
Oh, you're a smart man, you are. What he lacks in brawn, he makes up for in brain.
We would like her to potentially do the same thing that Rico does and follow the target around.
The hope is that Tina will be less standoffish with Rico.
Tina, target.
But she's still not emerging from her own private box.
Either she's smarter than us and she knows eventually she's going to get food no matter what happens, so she's just going to sit there and look at us and wait for us to treat her like a queen. Tina.
My hope for their relationship is that she sees the light and that she sees that what he's trying to do is for the good of both of them and that we end up with sloth offspring.
For some animals at the zoo, getting pregnant is the easy part. Bringing up the family is another matter. It's 10:30, and the family of 7 warthogs are still in bed.
Getting them out of their den first thing can be quite time-consuming, shall we say? Morning, guys! Some are early risers. Piggies, come on! Others on. Come on, then!
Magnum is the laziest of them all.
Piggies! Magnum isn't an early riser. The youngsters are excited to have the breakfast and the keen to come out, but Magnum is quite Sunday morning attitude. So. If he can, he'll spend most of his day relaxing in his mud wallow, sleeping.
With large tusks and warty faces, the hogs are not natural pin-ups.
I think a lot of people would describe warthogs as ugly pigs. I don't really find them ugly. I think they're all nice in their different ways, especially Magnum. In his younger days, was a very attractive warthog.
10-year-old Magnum has fathered 4 litters in as many years, and 2 of his sons are proving to be quite a handful.
Neville are the 2 young boys in the group. They are quite mischievous. and naughty. They're a dangerous duo, really. Usually if trouble's going on, they're not that far behind. They're growing up. The young males in the group, they will test their parents. They want to see what they can get away with. Egging each other on, really.
In the wild, adult male warthogs live alone and don't help rear the kids. But here, the family all live together, so Magnum can't shirk his responsibilities. To add to his burden, Mum Tamsin is pregnant again. And she needs peace and quiet.
Any disturbance can spook Tamsin. Making her feel like she's being threatened can result in the piglets not being raised by Tamsin, or even worse, kill them. I do worry about that.
Magnum may need to buck his ideas up. It's 2 months since Kumari's hormone treatment, and the keepers need to find out if it's worked.
We take fecal samples from Kumari every day, and they go to the analysts, and they tell us whether she's pregnant or not, basically.
This is the very glamorous part of the job.
The samples should indicate raised levels of the hormone progesterone, if Kumari's pregnant. But it's not good news. The team have drawn a blank.
In the captive situation, they should breed. I mean, three out of the tigers, rare as they are, they're quite easy to breed in captivity. Is that the lines themselves to be a little bit harder? There's obviously some behavioural aspect somewhere that is preventing it. It's almost like she'll go through a period of where she doesn't want to go anywhere near him. But he obviously can pick up on the signs, he'll smell all the hormones coming out of him and stuff. And she's not receptive.
In their natural habitat, the females would choose only the strongest, most aggressive males to mate with. But Iblis seems to have stopped making an effort.
It's a bit difficult in that setting, because in a captive setting there's no other males. There's no real threat, so it's very difficult for him to prove himself, I think. If she wants a male that she knows will look after that pride. I think he sometimes needs to be a bit more out there and a bit more aggressive towards her.
To make Iblis more attractive to Kumari, the keepers need to find a way to toughen him up and make him more like his cousins in the wild. It's 5 days since Florence gave birth. And her young foal, Angus, is finding his feet. Florence is proving to be a natural first-time mother. But Nadine is still showing no signs of going into labour. And getting bigger every day.
You know, she's like this pregnant lady, bless her, that just kind of like... gets up and sits down again and then gets up at the end and you can't really do anything.
The Grevy's zebra population has halved in the last 20 years. So every baby is precious. But all births are risky. Babs is particularly anxious. 2 years ago, she was faced with her worst nightmare.
A couple of years ago, we had a zebra called Michele. She was very special to me. She was pregnant for quite a long time. And on the 9th of September, I came in the morning. We realised instantly that something had gone horribly wrong doing foaling. The foal had been too big, so when she tried to give birth, it wouldn't come out, so the foal was dead. We had to then pull the foal out and try and see if we could save Michele, who was at this point dying from blood loss. Unfortunately, she had gone too fast. Just to have her take her last breath in my arms, that was horrendous.
Now all eyes are on Nadine, who must give birth soon. Iblis has failed to win the heart of lioness Kumari. And she's still not pregnant.
It's all about being noticed in the Animal Kingdom. You've got to be noticed. In the wild, they are ripped, and they need to be. Otherwise, they wouldn't survive. If he's a small, weaker lion, he wouldn't be anywhere. Females won't come anywhere near him. He's got to put on a bit of a scene, I think, to be honest, to be able to attract ladies.
The keepers are starting to think that Iblis's comfortable life at the zoo, with a daily diet of steak, might be affecting his virility.
He's not in the best shape because he's not having to hunt his food.
Because we were just putting small joints in and they had one each, he's got no reason to be aggressive because he knows he's going to get a bit of meat.
So they've come up with a plan. They're hoping that by hanging up carcasses for Iblis to tear down, he will become more muscular and impress Kumari.
Putting bigger stuff in, he can show that he's dominant. He should prove to her that he's got a bit about him.
Iblis's aim is to get the carcasses and try and keep them all for himself.
Speed seems to have reawakened Iblis's natural instincts.
Now we're giving them the carcasses, you know, being able to do different things with them, like tether them down, things like that, getting him to use all his muscles and get him fitter.
He's never shown any sort of behaviour like that before. He's got a bit more about him than I thought.
And over the weeks, the keepers gradually leave larger and larger carcasses.
See, by lifting, bits of him are starting to firm up.
It's a bit like a gym, really, because we can keep him physically fit in that way.
Kumari is starting to show more interest in Iblis.
It is changing behaviour slowly. It's not going to happen overnight.
But the keepers have already waited 5 years for cubs, with no joy. As part of the international breeding programme for the species, Iblis may have to be transferred to another zoo.
So if it doesn't work and Kumari doesn't become pregnant, we might have to look at moving Iblis out and getting another male in and seeing if he can do the job.
Tamsin's taken to her pen to give birth, leaving Dad Magnum in charge. But the kids are running riot. And it's ended badly.
Magnum recently lost the end of his tail. I do feel a bit sorry for him. We're not exactly sure what was the cause, but we think that it could have been a bite wound.
The culprit is still at large.
The young warthogs do like to nibble anything. Whether they just bit something that was near them as they were sitting down and relaxing, or whether they intentionally knew they were going for his tail, we don't know.
It seems Magnum's paying the price for having so many children. It's not just his tail that's missing.
These tusks are a little bit smaller. He used to have quite a nice hairdo, but I think since having the youngsters and everything, he's had a lot of hair loss.
And now, Magnum is about to become even more outnumbered. Partner Tamsin has just given birth to 3 more piglets, making him a dad of 8. And even though they're only a few days old, the piglets are already as feisty as their siblings.
The group group is up to 11 individuals. It's a big warthog group.
Magnum must find a way to reassert his position as dominant male. Florence's foal, Angus, is now a week old. And today, it seems he's about to witness the most remarkable moment of his young life. After a wait of 13 months, Nadine is finally going into labour. But she appears to be struggling.
Every single birth is different, so it could happen that the foal is in the wrong position. It could be that the foal is too big, so it can't come out properly. And mum will be pushing and pushing and nothing will happen. It could be that it's a stillborn. It's all jeopardy.
Her 2.5-year-old daughter, Merida, is staying close.
There's not a lot I can do. I can see she's uncomfortable. If you could just tell them, you know, it's going to be all right, you know, just take it easy. I think literally she'd kick me out if I started touching her and, like, helping her.
Half an hour later, Nadine's foal finally makes its appearance. But the keepers are concerned that Nadine hasn't stood up.
Nadine doesn't look right. I don't know if it's completely out, but Nadine is flat out.
Merida hasn't left her mum's side. Dad, Mac, can only watch on from his neighbouring field.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
Minutes later, Nadine finally struggles to her feet and encourages her newborn to do the same. Curious to meet the new foal, but Nadine is very protective. For older daughter Merida, the arrival of two new foals means her world has changed forever.
She's going to have to learn the hard way that she's no longer mum's number one, because obviously new foal will be, and Nadine won't have time for Merida, and that can be quite harsh to watch because it's tough loving. It's part of life, and that's what we do. We grow up, unfortunately.
With the birth of two new foals, Chester's rare Grevy zebra herd has nearly doubled in size. Nadine's foal, Eleanor, is just 2 days old. Florence's foal, Angus, is now 9 days old.
To have two foals on the ground, running around, absolutely causing trouble already, is fantastic. You can't ask for any better.
They're starting to put their hooves to the test and showing their true colours.
The little the male, the little stallion, he's so funny and he's so confident. He's gonna be an absolute plonker when he goes older. And the little filly, she's timid in the background, doing everything right, just as her mum says, you know. But all the little personalities are coming out now, and they're fantastic. It's a great feeling.
But it's not all happy families. Nadine's older daughter, Merida, is showing signs of jealousy.
Annoying big sister that wants to put her foot in it, and she wants to put her head in it, and then she wants to bite it, and then she wants to play with it.
Oops. Sibling rivalry among zebras can have serious consequences.
Zebras when they've not been allowed back into the herd because mum's now got a new toy. Merida's just going to have to grow up and deal with it, and she's going to have to take her new responsibility as a big sister. She's sulked for a while. She's sulked for 3 weeks. Luckily, we've got a lot of space for our zebras. If they'd have a fallout, you know, like any family would, they have time to go separate ways, and then they can sort of meet in the middle. And that's what's happened. She's not bullying anyone, and they're not bullying her. And she's doing really well, bless her.
In the warthog field, the older children are still misbehaving. And Mum Tamsin's flat out with the little ones. But rather than attempt to control his offspring, it seems Magnum has decided to look out for himself instead.
Magnum put his foot down around food. He wants first pick. He'll take all the good stuff and leave all the broccoli for everybody else.
And after breakfast, Magnum can go back to doing what he does best. Appears to have been a change of heart. Iblis' new regime has made Kumari notice him once more.
That we can say, yes, she's pregnant and we've got babies.
And under the cover of darkness, Rico the Sloth's persistence looks like it's paying off with Tina.
It would be just out of this world if we could have a baby from these two. It would be a first for me personally. But it'd be a huge achievement for the zoo as a whole.
Next time, Kendari the Babarusa has got nightmare neighbours.
What is our trouble when she's inside? They get pebbles in their paws and they sort of smash them against their front door.
I Raz is having first date jitters.
We've all been there, and hopefully, with a bit of practice, he'll get to fourth base soon.
Come on, Squeaky. Relax that bladder.
And there are hopes of a new arrival in the realm of the Red Ape.
We've just dipped the pregnancy test in the jug. One orangutan, two orangutan, three orangutan.
You can see when the sea goes out, sunken U-boats, ancient footprints, history to touch, Britain at low tide Saturday at 8. For next tonight, a change to some listings. Off with its head, just the bungalow, mind you. Incredible transformation and grand design.